Spirit of the living God, come forth fresh on me. Come wake me from my sleep. Flow through the caverns of my soul.
Well, this is indeed a holy moment because we are the family of God and we are here to exalt and honor the name of our Lord. And so we welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. We are just hoping and praying that you will be able to meet the Lord today. We have expectation that we will see the glory of God today in our midst, and we just want to welcome you. Let's start with some prayer, shall we? Father God, we welcome you here, Lord, in our midst. Father, we want to see more of you today, Father God. Lord, we believe that you are here now. And God, I pray that we can just in full abandon give ourselves to you, Lord, as we worship your name on high. All the struggles and challenges we face this week, Lord, we just lay at your feet, Father. And God, we just pray that you just allow your love and your peace to overwhelm us today, Father. You are great. You are awesome. And you are worthy to be praised. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and let's worship the Lord together.
Jesus.
sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus, your name is beautiful. Your name is powerful. God, as we continue to sing about who you are, and we're here together to learn about you and what you are to us and who you are for us, may the words that we sing, may the words that we hear from you in our hearts be just stapled and engraved in our hearts for the rest of our lives. God, we love you, and we're here to thank you for who you are for us.
Yeah.
Hello, good morning everyone, welcome. Good morning kids, you guys are so much joy. We're so happy to see you this morning. So we're gonna bless the kids to go off to their children's church. Thanks for being with us in worship. Woo-hoo. All right, kiddos, let's go with the teachers. Welcome everyone, my name is Molly and I'm one of the interim co-pastors here at the Monterey Park campus along with my husband Abner. And it's my joy to be able to welcome you guys this morning. We're so glad that you're here. And for those of you that are visiting us for the first time, especially this cheerleading crowd over here, we're so glad that you're with us. Woo, woo, woo. And I met some other folks that are visiting us for the first time as well. So we're so glad that you're here. And we look forward to getting a chance to meet you this morning. So if you're starting, I don't know about you, but that last song was just catching me. There's something about He is healing right now. He is hope. He is life. He is joy. He is love. And that's my prayer for us this morning, is that we would encounter it. That Jesus, we've been doing that series, Today is the Day, that we would have that encounter, that He is those things for us today, right now, that you would encounter Jesus' healing and love and peace and joy with you today. So amen? Amen. Awesome. So I'm going to go ahead and give us our announcements today and let you know some of the fun things going on in our family here at Trinity. So today, after the service, we have an opportunity to be family together and join in the Thanksgiving potluck. So as I think about Thanksgiving, I think of family around a table. I think of gratitude. I know you guys are thinking about all your plans coming up. Well, today is an opportunity for us to be a church family and join in that family and gratitude together as we have a Thanksgiving feast and enjoy one another. So please join us after the service to be able to take part in that. And then next, we have a couple Christmas announcements coming up. There's also a bake sale. Well, we're going to change up the order of announcements. There's also a bake sale that's happening. And then on the way, I just have a special heart for this. So these cheerleaders are here, and we're going to have an announcement in a minute. They're selling baked goods. I just want to make sure, as we're going to Thanksgiving, we want to just buy up all their baked goods. You know, we want to support them in every way. And so we have a special bake sale, and Jim Marvulli's here to be able to share a little bit about the cheerleading squad that he's working with and let us know about the bake sale.
Guys, come on. All of you guys, come on. Real quickly, we're going to show a little video. You can turn the light. Thank you. Good morning. Come up here, girls. Come on. As you can see, that's my family away from family. Cougar Pride. These girls represent it really well. Come on up here. And we're trying to keep this program going. And the girls, they are continuing on. Football has ended. They still got cheer competitions to go to. The stinky girls here, as I call them. And they will tell you what my name is on the field. Go ahead, girls. So somehow these guys got to me this year. And I'm here to support them, brought them to my church. And we have great board members here, Flower, Anna, Jackie. They've been through the Cougar program too. Cougar programs have been around for 50 years. And we're a small group, 85 kids total. We weren't allowed to use the high school fields. Took away a lot of revenue from us that we used to continue on for the girls to go on and participate in their competitions. So that's why I invited them down here, do the bake sale. Thank you to everybody who's bought already. John, your secret's safe with me. I saw him carrying a big, we'll keep that from Sonia. But we're here to fundraise for them and hopefully keep them going in their competitions without more money coming out of their parents' pockets. It's very expensive all the way around, and the more fundraising we can do. So thank you again. If anybody come out there and support, as Molly said, buy up all those baked goods. Let's help send these guys to more competitions. It builds strong character, teamwork, and friendships, as you can see out there. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Jim. I don't know about you, but like when he shared, I got teary, you know, like you just see Jim's heart for these guys as he shares about them. And I know he works for the football team as well. And so, man, that's what it's all about, is we want to be a part of God's work in the world. I love that. And so let's make sure we buy up all their baked goods and actually get to know them. I got to meet them this morning, just their sweet faces. And it's just a joy to be able to have you guys. So awesome. A couple other Christmas things that are happening. We support a ministry called Angel Tree. And Angel Tree is a ministry that cares for children that have a parent that's in jail. And we want to make sure that all those kids get gifts during the holiday season and have the joy of being able to open up a gift. And so we support them as a church by buying gifts for those children. And today after the service and next week after the service, if there are names left, there'll be an opportunity for you to go out and find Karen Bustamante in the courtyard. Karen's right here. And then you can get a name for a child, and then you can buy and purchase a gift for them. And then you can return that gift back here on December 3rd. Here we'll be collecting the gifts. And then on December 9th, we're going to have an Angel Tree party to be able to invite the families and celebrate with the kids. And they'll be able to open their gifts. And it's just a time of joy and a time of being a part of, again, God's work in the world. So come. I want to get one. I missed it last year. We were out of town that first weekend. It's like, oh, the names were all gone after that first weekend. So make sure, grab one today. And then on the 26th, after the service, on Sunday the 26th, we will be having our annual tree trimming time here to be able to decorate our service and make it look festive. So I don't know about your family, but in my family, decorating the Christmas tree is actually a really big deal. We have a lot of tradition about it, and it's a lot of fun. And so I just want to invite you into the tradition of this church to be a part of just decorating it and the joy of being together as a family in the midst of that. So that's the 26th, right after the service. We'll be doing that together. And then the last is there's an opportunity for some of the Bridge youth, young adults, in their 20s, are going to be having a Friendsgiving potluck tomorrow night. And so it's going to be at Jeff's house at 7 o'clock. So if you're in your 20s and you're interested in getting to know more folks like that in the church and you want to join in, please take your connection card that you got in your bulletin and say, I'm interested in the Friendsgiving, and put it in the offering. And then that will be an opportunity for Jeff and folks to get in touch with you to make sure you could join in tomorrow night. Okay, so let's just review some of the, Sunday, December 3rd. Okay, here's the upcoming things happen. All right, we're just sort of blitzing through. So Thanksgiving potluck today, Angel Tree and bake sale, grab goods and a name to give a gift to today, Friendsgiving tomorrow, and then we have Christmas decorating next Sunday, and then the communion meal happening on Sunday, December 3rd. Awesome. I'm going to invite up Wes, and he's going to go ahead and tell us a little bit more from the board. So.
Thank you, Molly. Good morning. I'm going to invite up Linda and Joanne and Veronica. So we are your board members on this campus, and this is a quick announcement. We just wanted to let you know and ask you specifically if you would pray for the board and Greg on this Tuesday, the 21st. We are going to begin the process of looking at resumes for a new lead pastor. We also are going to be on that day giving Greg a picture, pictorial picture, but a word picture of our church, what our values are. This is all coming out of the surveys that we discussed and that we all participated in, and it's about our mission, it's about our vision, it's about who we are, and this is, like as Linda was saying just as we were coming in here, it's kind of like our side of the dating website. With our pastor, our profile, thank you, yes, our dating profile as a church, so we can attract that very most attractive him or her head pastor that we are looking for to come and join us and bring us into our future with the Lord. So we really would ask that you would be praying throughout this process, but in particular, Tuesday night, if you would take some time to pray, and in the lead up to that, that's when we're going to start looking at some resumes. And we just wanted to let you guys know. Again, if you have any questions, you can ask any of us, and we're happy to give you any kind of information that you would like about the process as we go, and we'll make an announcement next time we got something to say about it. All right. Thank you all very much. Good morning. And here's Jeff to talk about offertory.
Hello, good morning. My name is Jeff. I'm the administrator here on the MP campus, and we just threw out a lot of information at you. If you didn't miss anything, just write on your connection cards, like, hey, I missed all the announcements today. Send me some more information, and we'll do that, all right? Because we know that there's a lot of things going on, and we kind of blitz through them really, really quickly because of time, and we want to respect your time, but at the same time, we also want to know, let you guys know what's happening and the opportunities that are happening here, all right? With that, and we're going to move into our time of offering. If you call this your home church, feel free to give to that generously. But if you do not, if you're a guest with us, thank you so much for being here. You can just let the offering plate pass you by. We're actually going to be taking two offerings today. One of them is our regular tithes and offerings. And our second one is for our World Evangelism Fund. And our World Evangelism Fund is a fund that enables us as a worldwide church organization, the Church of the Nazarene, to be able to reach the ends of the earth. Which is kind of a weird saying because the earth is a spherical thing. There's no end, but we want to be able to impact the kingdom for his purposes, and to do that, we need more manpower and resources, and to do that, we pull our resources together, and we do things like build schools, and we build hospitals, and we pay for things like the missionaries that go out and reach places that still do not know the gospel, right? And so this is all for kingdom purposes, and so there's going to be two separate offerings today. In your bulletin, you might find one of these nifty green things. I know it says Compassionate Ministry, but we don't have any special envelopes for the World Evangelism Fund. If you want to give to that, just write it on here with your name, and we'll credit you for that. But again, it's a separate offering. So we're going to be taking two offerings today. The first one is just our regular one, and the second one is our World Evangelism Fund. And to kind of get you into the space of that, we're going to watch a short little video about what the World Evangelism Fund is.
The Church of the Nazarene's ministry to Myanmar refugees is exploding in Thailand, Singapore, across Asia, and around the world. With only 6% of Myanmar's population identifying as Christians, existing ministries and church plants supported by the World Evangelism Fund are vital to reaching this people group. Because of gifts received through the Thank Offering, missionaries like Kunjar are able to go where the church is not yet. These are her words.
My mom always prayed for me. She always encouraged me to stop walking and work for ministry. When my mom passed away, God reminded me of her prayer. It is not by chance to be involved in this ministry, but the leading of the Lord.
After receiving her license, Kunjar relocated to the Thailand district so she could work with missionaries Bill and Mil Kwan to reach the Myanmar migrants in that country. The effort to reach the Myanmar people doesn't stop there. Cross-cultural church partnerships are emerging across the globe, including a partnership in Indianapolis, Indiana, where a Myanmar pastor began a ministry to reach the 15,000 Myanmar people who have settled in that city. These are just a few examples of how the Church of the Nazarene is spreading the gospel of Christ thanks to the World Evangelism Fund. Amazing things are also happening in Armenia, Mongolia, West Africa, and around the world, as the church brings the gospel to new places and reaches new people groups. The Church of the Nazarene depends on the World Evangelism Fund to keep these ministries alive and growing. When you give to it through the thank offering, you enable God's church to continue to reach new places, form lifelong relationships, and make Christ-like disciples in the nations. We celebrate the gifts God has given us, and as one body, join together to go where the church is not yet.
All right, again, so I'm gonna call up our ushers, and we're gonna stand in a little bit, and we're gonna sing the doxology. But before that, I just wanna, again, reiterate, if you are a guest with us, if you're a first-time visitor, if you are not a Christian, don't feel obligated in any way to put anything into the offering plate, just let it pass you by, all right? Your presence is our gift to us today. Thank you so much. So we're gonna stand together, and we're gonna sing the doxology, if you would please. We thank you so much for this opportunity to be able to be generous because you are first generous with us. We thank you so much, God, that we get to be a blessing to those in other parts of the world that we don't even get to see. And God, just kind of increase our faith so that we can give in faith and in trust in you, that you are impacting the world at large. Some of us are not physically able or just kind of in a season where we can go abroad, and that's okay. But you've called us each individually as Christians to be able to impact the kingdom in a certain way. And we thank you for that opportunity. We thank you and we love you, Jesus. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Worship is holy name. Sing like
One thing that you are thankful for. Go ahead and do that.
Stay today. Lunch.
Yeah.
good morning, everybody. Am I on? Well, Pastor Jeff just told me something that he should never tell a preacher. He said, "You have a lot of time today." He says we have a lot of time, so maybe I should just extend my sermon to like a couple more hours. What do you think? There's the energy. I love that. Before we start, I thought that I should what is that word when you meet someone? No. Introduce! Oh, that's where I am today. I can't adult today, as they say. I would like to introduce the young man that was standing here and leading us in worship. His name is Edwin, and his beautiful wife, Jennifer. With Pastor Johnny and Gloria and some of our singers out, he was gracious enough to come over to the Monterey Park side and lead us in worship. So we are just grateful for you and your ministry with us, Edwin. Thank you. Another announcement. One of our... Oh, I'm glad I have more time today. Okay. Another announcement. One of our worship leaders could not come today, and the reason why is because she just had a baby. Yeah. So Janelle and Sam just had a baby, and his name is Micah Evan Yao. He was born at 9:05 last night, and he was about 7 pounds and five ounces. So we are welcoming another addition to our church family, so we're really excited about that. So before we go on, let's do what we always do on Sunday morning together as a church family. Let's just pray together. The words on the screen. O Lord, our God, you have chosen to make yourself known through your creation, your word, your Son, and your Spirit. Now reveal your glory to us and through us, the church. Speak to us, form us, lead us, and dwell in us. Teach us today how to love as Jesus loves. Become the stranger, heal the sick, and care for the poor. To bear good news, build bridges, and bring your people home. For Christ in us is the hope of glory. May your perfect will prevail in us this day. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And let me just add to that prayer this morning. Father God, to some of those mornings where we feel like we can't just get out of bed, Father, and God, for those of us that are feeling that way, Lord, we just praise your name, God, because you are able. You give us strength, Lord. And I pray for your Spirit to strengthen each of us this morning. And Father, that you strengthen me, Lord, and give me discernment to your Spirit as I lead our people in your word today, as I minister through your scriptures today, Father God. Be with me. Pray for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So it's good to be here with you today. I love coming once in a while as I do, and to be able to see some of your faces, and especially, we just came back from a women's retreat a couple of weeks ago, and my heart is even more warmed to see you again, especially for those that I have not been able to see for the last couple of weeks. Albert and I just got back from a trip up to NorCal, where, as most of you know, Wes from our board, he was discussing that our board is on this journey right now, looking for new pastoral leadership, and the reason why is because Pastor Albert and I are moving up north, where he is the district superintendent for over 70 churches. And so the NorCal district is divided into about 7 zones. And for the most part, we've been able to visit the pastors in each of these zones, except for the Redwood zone.
And so for those of you that know your California geography, I learned it for the first time this last week. We made our way up to Fortuna and then Eureka and Arcata. Does that sound familiar to you? I've never heard these words before in my life before. And we traveled all the way up north to the Oregon border to a little city named Crescent City. So this is our Redwood Zone. It was our first time meeting the pastors up there. And prior to the trip, Albert said that we would have to fly into Oakland and then hop into a car and then drive for 5 hours up the coast and then visit our churches in Eureka, Arcata, and Fortuna and then travel 2 hours up further to Crescent City. I wasn't very thrilled about it, let me tell you. I just gave him a weak smile and I said, yay, yippee. I wasn't thrilled until I got there. And I realized the beauty of our Redwood Zone up in NorCal. And it is so beautiful that Albert and I look forward to going again, this time with our children, and to explore the beauty that beheld us there this last week. And on top of the beautiful scenery, the people there are so amazing. We met a number of faithful pastors that are loving on their congregations and on their communities in ways that were so very inspiring. So many times I found myself moved to tears. The trip was such a blessing to Albert and I, and to think that I was dragging my feet at the thought of traveling all the way up there. You know, I had no idea. So we are currently in a sermon series called Today is the Day, Living in the Perfect Will of God. And I've heard from many of you that this sermon series have spoken to you because you have indeed been waiting on God for something to happen in your life. Waiting perhaps unnecessarily because something about the way you understand God or the way you understand the gospel is preventing you from receiving all of God's blessings today. Because today is the day. What is God calling you to do today that you're putting off for tomorrow? How should your faith move you? And what actions should your faith result in? And Pastor Albert, he's been reading from 2 Corinthians 6:2, which says this: as God's co-workers, and we are all co-workers here in the gospel, as God's co-workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. And he discussed last week that maybe the reason why we're not as excited about this is because we don't quite understand what that means. Maybe our reluctance is sort of like my reluctance of going up to the Redwood Zone, right? I didn't want the traveling hassles, you know, the time and the inconvenience it would cost me, not realizing the beauty and the blessings that were waiting for me there. And perhaps our journey to a full committed relationship with Jesus Christ is like that. You know, we don't want the hassles or the time or the inconveniences it takes. And we don't realize the beauty and the blessings that wait for us when we finally say, today is the day. So this series is supposed to challenge us to take a hold of everything that God has for us, not next year, not next month, not next week, but everything he has for us today. Today is the day. Jesus shared the gospel, and he said this. He said that the kingdom of God is at hand. It's right here. Right? And that our abundant lives filled with God's power and his glory, it starts today. Now is a time of God's favor. Now is a day of salvation. And yet, as Christians, I feel like we find ourselves a little sleepy sometimes, a little sluggish and lethargic. And we're not pursuing the beauty and the blessings that the Lord has for us. Why is that? What is not clicking in our heads? What are our hearts not absorbing? And I think we can answer this by asking three questions that would help us to seize the day. Carpe diem, right? And live life according to all the possible best that God wills for our lives. So what are these questions? Today we're going to look into the life of Paul the Apostle and look for our answers there. So Paul the Apostle, he is one of the most dynamic followers of Jesus, right? And there is so much we can learn from his life, starting from his conversion into Christianity. It is probably the most dramatic of all conversions in the Bible. And we find the narrative in Acts 9 where Paul, and he's known as Saul at the time, and I'm going to interchange those names so don't get too confused. Sometimes I'll say Paul, sometimes I'll say Saul. But at this time, Saul is mercilessly persecuting the early church. He's persecuting the early church. And I'm going to read from the New King James Version today, which is, I think, probably the first time I've preached out of that version, because there's an interpretation there that I think is really quite profound that's not actually in the other translations. So this is the New King James Version. So Acts 9. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of the way, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. So he was breathing threats and murder against the disciples. It was like oxygen to him, right? And he had already wreaked havoc on the church in Jerusalem, but that wasn't enough. He wanted to travel 150 miles to persecute Christians in Damascus, to hunt them down, to capture, to imprison, to punish and kill men and women who claimed Jesus as their personal savior. Paul was a first century terrorist. And verse 3 says this. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven. Then he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, Who are you, Lord? And then the Lord said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. So he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what do you want me to do? Then the Lord said to him, Arise and go in the city, and you will be told what you must do. And the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no one. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither ate nor drank. That's pretty dramatic, isn't it? Dramatic conversion. You know, it's midday and suddenly there's this bright light all around Paul from heaven. There's this supernatural dimension that breaks through on earth for a moment, and Saul is suddenly surrounded by heaven's light. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And imagine Saul's anguish. All this time, Saul had deceived himself to believe that he was killing Christians out of obedience to the Lord. And here he finds out that he was persecuting God himself and murdering innocent, true followers. How must Saul have felt? You know, the shame, the remorse, his whole life, he studied and he worked and he served the one true God, only to find out that he had missed the whole point of it all. The whole point, the pinnacle, the climax of the history of God, the entire purpose, he had missed it. He was persecuting God, the one he sought to serve. And upon realizing this, we see Paul asking two very important questions here in verse 5 and verse 6. The first question, who are you, Lord? The second question, Lord, what do you want me to do? And I wonder if these two questions are not the two most important questions we can ask in life. Who are you, Lord? And Lord, what do you want me to do? Paul asks, who are you? And the answer that is given is this. I am Jesus. Jesus, the whole point of it all. Jesus, the climax of the history of God. Jesus, the entire purpose. He was the Son of God. He is the creator of the universe, the Most High King, our Savior, the Lord, the light of the world, the Almighty One. Jesus, the Messiah, the one whom people like Saul put to death on a cross. So often when I preach, there is a point in the sermon when I just give these titles of Jesus and I just, you know, call them out. And I fear that sometimes we lack the awe that the name of Jesus should inspire. Do we know the greatness of our God? Do we marvel at the works of his hands? Do we tremble in his presence? Who are you, Lord? How often do we reflect and meditate on that question? Who are you? So I want to show a short video, a video clip, and I want to show how this video clip just sheds a little light on the answer to this question. And I'm not quite sure how to do it. I double click?
Yes.
Pardon?
Photos?
I'm sorry, I've never done this. Carlos, he saves the day. Oh, really? Photos.
Great is our God. Sing with me.
So Louis Giglio, he's a pastor and founder of the Passion Movement. He did a conference tour where he described the vastness of the universe to demonstrate the greatness of God. And he also broke down the complexity of the human body to demonstrate God's love for us. And some of the scientific facts he shares are absolutely mind-blowing. So in the video, you saw how small the Milky Way actually is, right? Really, really small. And if our solar system, which includes, as we know, the sun and the planets, the moon and everything in it, right? If the Milky Way was the size of the entire North American continent, the solar system would be the size of a quarter. Okay, so this is our solar system, and the Milky Way is as big as the North American continent. And we saw how small it was in the video. Did you know that there are over 100 billion stars in our Milky Way galaxy alone? And if I counted all the stars in the Milky Way, one star per second, like one, two, three, four, and I started counting all the stars in the Milky Way, it would take me 2,000 years to count them all. And did you know what the latest count for the number of galaxies? The Milky Way galaxy is one. How many galaxies there are in the observable universe? 200 billion. And the biggest star we found thus far is called Canis Majoris. And you could fit 7 quadrillion Earths inside Canis Majoris. And a lot of us are like, wow, that sounds like a big number, but what does that actually mean? 7 quadrillion. If the Earth was the size of a golf ball, right, do you know how many golf balls would fit in this entire state of Texas? It would cover the entire state of Texas 22 inches deep of golf balls, and that's how many Earths can fit in this star. God did that, right? God, he did that. He created 100 billion stars in our galaxy alone, 200 billion galaxies in the observable universe. He created the whole universe. God did that. And it says in Psalm 33, it says this, by the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. Their starry hosts by the breath of his mouth. So Canis Majoris, he breathed it into being. God did that. Do we live like we serve that God? Do we live like we have faith in the one who breathes out stars? Do we picture this kind of God when we're singing worship songs on a Sunday morning? How can we not have faith in the promises of God when he can do things like this? In Romans 8, it says, if God is for us, who could be against us? This God. Our sin, however, makes God small in our eyes, doesn't it? It makes God small, and it puffs ourselves up. You know, we put God in a little box that we can carry around, and we demand things from that little God in our little box, that we want things our way, that we want him to grant our wishes. And God is so big, our mortal minds cannot even comprehend just how big he is. So Paul asks, who are you, Lord? And if he could only fully comprehend, if only we could fully comprehend the answer to that question. And what is more profound is that this holy, great, majestic, almighty God, he loves you and he loves me. So imagine 200 billion galaxies in the observable universe, right? The Milky Way, that was the size of the North American continent, our solar system would be this big. How small are we? What are we even on this quarter? We couldn't even see it with a microscope. We are tiny. We are so small. But God loves us. He created you, and He made you from one cell from your mother, one cell from your father, right? And it merged together, and half of your mom's chromosomes and half of your father's chromosomes came together to make a new DNA code. Okay, this DNA code uses four characters, four nucleotides, and they began to write out what is a 3 billion character description of who you are, written, as you can say, in the language of God, describing how God had ordained you to be. Right? If a person were to read your DNA one character per second, night and day, it would take that person 96 years to just read the description of you. Now, I sound like I know what I'm talking about, but I really don't. But all I know is that this demonstrates in such a mind-blowing way that God loves you and He loves me. Psalm 33 also says this, "For He spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood fast. From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all of humanity. From His dwelling place He watches all who live on earth. He who forms the hearts of them all and is intimately acquainted with everything they do. The eyes of the Lord are on those who fear Him, on those who hope in His unfailing love." Second question. Paul asks, "What do you want me to do?" For Paul, it is evident that his faith had to have action. It resulted in actions. And it's not that we have to earn the favor of God, right? It's not that we have to work for a ticket to get to heaven. Just for Paul, it is just impossible to get a glimpse of how great God's love is for him and not respond with a passionate, life-changing love of his own. He gives his whole life over to the Lord. And Paul is thinking, "Oh, great God, creator of the universe, what would you have me to do with my life? It's all yours, all of me. I can't even think about holding back." And is this our response to God? When you wake up in the morning, what are your first thoughts? What am I going to wear? What should I eat? Where should I go? What should I buy? What can I do to make me happy? What do I want? Or do we wake up in the morning and we say, "God, Lord, what do you want me to do today?" Let's go back to Paul's narrative for a moment. Remember, he had no sight, right? He couldn't see for 3 days. And he chose not to eat or drink for those 3 days. And then the Lord calls out to a disciple, and his disciple was named Ananias. And the Lord tells Ananias to go to Saul and pray for his sight to be restored. And this is how Ananias responds. "Lord, I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." And so then Ananias went to the house and entered it. and placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. And then get this. Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once, he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. You know, I love this because Paul, he wastes no time. In verse 20, he says, at once he began to preach the gospel. You know, Paul, he did not wallow in his own shame and his own grief and say, oh, I'm not worthy. You know, he didn't allow his past and his emotional baggage keep him from doing what God had called him to do. He didn't say, no, wait until I get more training. Wait till I get more equipping. Wait till I learn more about this person of Jesus. And wait till I become more equipped before I go out and serve. Paul, he didn't question his authority, his ability, his spiritual maturity to do what God designed him to do since birth. And you know, Ananias, that would be the typical response to any Christian that was receiving Paul and his message. They would be saying, Paul, the guy that went murdering my brothers and sisters, that is the guy that you're ascending to us, Lord? Paul knew this. He knew the response that people would have. Yet, he chose not tomorrow, but today to serve the Lord with all his heart. Lord, what do you want me to do? Have you asked that of him? I know a lot of you have. I know that. But have we asked that of him? Have we wondered? Have we dreamt? Have we imagined what the Lord would have us do today? Or are we letting just the currents of life just drag us in the undertow and just following just a slice of what the Lord has planned for us? You know, this abundant life. You know, a healthy marriage. Children who follow God. Reconciled relationships. A thriving church family. You know, emotional, physical, and spiritual healing. Or living a life that makes a difference in the world. When we talk about God's will, the word will in the original Greek is thelema. Right? It means God's preferred will. It means God's best offer to his people, which can be accepted or rejected. Okay, and don't forget, we're talking about God, right? God who created the universe. That great big God, it is his best offer for your life. It's his best offer. The God who breathes out stars, right, and shouts the world into existence. It's that God, his best offer. The third question is not in our passage today. The question is, why? And I think the third question might be the most powerful of all. Paul doesn't ask this question here, but he answers this question over and over and over again in his epistles to the church. And the question is, why? Why should I care who the Lord is? Why should I do what the Lord wants me to do? Why should I offer up my whole life to him and to trust him and put faith with actions in him and love him? Why? And we could answer, because he loved us first, right? Because he sent his son to die on the cross for us, because we are set apart for God and we are called to obedience. And all these are good and true reasons, but I'd have to say, I don't think the faith of the typical American church truly shows an understanding of the full meaning of God's love, or even Jesus' death and resurrection, or our call to obedience to all these things, to love God with all our hearts, to love people. I think the question is, do we know the why? And do we feel the why? I want to show another video clip. It kind of demonstrates the why. And there's a Christian stand-up comedian, and his name is Michael Jr. And he performs around the country using stand-up comedy to share the love of Jesus and to inspire people to walk in purpose. So during his act, there's a short segment, he calls it break time. And during break time, what he does is he just randomly chooses somebody in the audience and he just starts having a conversation, totally impromptu, unscripted. And then funny things happen. So one break time he had was truly inspiring. And this is the clip that I want to show you. The question is, which one do I choose? Let me see if this one is correct.
Brother, right there. Yeah, yeah. What's your name, bro?
Daryl.
I'm gonna need you to slow down with all that, bro. For real, you're scaring the white people. You can't do that, Daryl.
I'm sorry, bro.
You're scaring me too, though. Wow. Well, what do you do for a living, Daryl?
I work at Oak Ridge Military Academy. I'm the music director there.
Musical director at Oak Ridge Musical Academy.
Okay. Yeah.
But you got a deep voice, man. I would not want to get you mad. Jonathan, come here. You're like, oh, snap. Nine Jonathans show up. It's amazing, dude. So you're a musical director.
Cool. Yes, sir.
All right, so let me get a couple bars of like Amazing Grace. Can you do the first part of that? Let me hear. We didn't plan this, just so y'all know. We didn't plan this at all. I'm just randomly talking. Go ahead.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Now, what you give me the version is if your uncle just got out of jail, you got shot in the back when you was a kid. I'm just saying, let me see the hood version real quick, if you know which version I'm talking about. Just see if that exists. Let me see what you got.
Amazing Grace, how sweet.
So what is your rendition of Amazing Grace? Is it like the first one? You know, pretty competent, accurate, quite lovely, I thought. Or is your rendition of Amazing Grace like the second one? where you feel God's grace from the top of your head all the way down to your tippy toes. Where you realize with all your heart that God of the universe, the God of utter beauty, majesty, and power manifested in the flesh as an infant born in a stable, as the Savior left to die hanging on a cross for all our sins. Is this your rendition of amazing grace? Amazing, astounding, indescribable grace. How sweet the sound. That this great, powerful God would save a wretch like me. This is the why. I want us to think about what the Lord has for us. You know, the beauty and the blessings that I don't feel like most of us have really taken hold of, fully embraced with our whole lives. And the thing is, God, the one that breathes out star, he wishes this for you. Out of the goodness of his heart, he desires a life that is thriving and abundant for you. What is it that the Lord wants for your life? And Pastor Albert, a couple of weeks ago, he preached and he said, think about that something that you have yearned for and prayed for and desired for with all your heart. Something that have you've just been waiting and waiting for and have not received yet. And as you think about this something, I want you to lead you through a type of prayer. It's called the prayer of recollection. Something that we did at our women's retreat that I thought was really powerful. It's actually Jennifer Sato that led us through this. This type of prayer is very contemplative. And there'll be times of silence that I would love for you to just contemplate what the Holy Spirit is saying to you. And then respond with prayers of your own. So I'll be guiding you through some steps and I'll give you some space and some silence for you to pray on your own. So I just ask you to close your eyes, still your heart, and just let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Tell the Lord that you are present and that you have opened your heart to him and that you intend to learn from him, that your heart is open to the truth of what is going on in your life. Think about all the reasons that hold you back from living the life God wants from you. Think about the limitations, the struggles, and the weaknesses of the flesh that keep wanting to define you. Is it an angry spirit? Is it fear, arrogance, or pride? Is it envy or jealousy, anxiety, impatience? Is it being judgmental, critical, unkind, unloving? Is it doubt? Confess these to the Lord. Be open to the truth that in Christ and by means of his death and resurrection, you are already dead to the inherited sinful nature. Be open to the truth that God's grace is perfected in your weakness, and that nothing can separate you from the love of God. You are forgiven. You are free. You are clothed in righteousness. Now think about all the roles that define you. Sister, mother, husband, son, grandma, student, employer, teacher, doctor, manager, pharmacist, pastor, retiree. Place all these roles at the feet of Jesus. Because above all these roles, at the core, your role is child of God, daughter of the Most High King, son of Almighty God. Confess the ways you put your other roles above this one. You are a child of God first. And in light of that, how will you parent? How will you study? How will you work? How will you care for your parents? Ask the Lord to speak to you about these things. And conclude this step by affirming that apart from Christ, you can do nothing, but with God, all things are possible. Affirm to your soul and the Lord your true identity in Christ. Own who you are in Christ as a new creation, a masterpiece of God, created anew and afresh in Christ. In union with Christ, you are no longer condemned, but accepted in him, your debt of sin being canceled. This step is an invitation to open to your true self by the Spirit, that you have already put on compassion, kindness, humility, patience, trust, love, self-control, peace, goodness, and all the fruits of the Spirit. Be open to the truth of this, whether this is truly what you experience or not, and talk with the Lord about it. Confess any unbelief. You are forgiven by God. You are adopted by God. You are chosen by God. You belong to God. You are loved by God. And you are light by God. Resolve in your heart and in prayer to obey the Lord, to put off the old and put on the new, by setting your mind continually on Christ, who is your life. Resolve to yourself and to God that as the appropriate moments arise, you will let go of any sin or old self residue and live out who you are from the heart. Ask the Lord to help you make your mind and heart open to Christ all day and all night. Ask for wisdom and strength to lay aside the old person and its ways and to simply put on Christ, to obey him in all things and to reaffirm who you really are in Christ. Be still and soak in the truths you have just prayed. Ask for clarity now. Ask the Lord what he wants for your life today. What does he want you to do today in order to receive all that he has to offer you, the best he has to offer you? What decisions need to be made? What attitudes need to be changed? What needs to be forgiven? What posture needs to be taken? What do we need to believe? Conclude with a prayer of thanksgiving to the Lord. Thank him for who he is, for who you are in light of who he is.
There is no one like you. There is none besides you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Let's stand.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Live for you. We live for you. And all
I don't know about you, but as Christine was sharing and she was talking about who God is and his bigness of who he is and who we are in him, that we are his sons and daughters, I just had the cry of my soul was like, I want to live in that reality more fully. I want to know that kind of God that's so big and so vast and so intricate. Like, I don't understand that. And I'm so tired of living in shame myself. I'm like, God, I want to be free in a fresh way. Like, God, I don't want to be stuck in myself. I want more of God in my life. So I just want to pray a blessing over us that we would be able to behold the truth of who God is and enter in more fully to the truth of who we are and walk in that with God. So God, we just say that you are very big and you are very vast, and we don't even have the imagination to fully understand who you are, but we want to worship you. God, we want to be in awe of you. We want to, Holy Spirit, would you allow us to grasp more of who you are, God? I want to know you, God. We want to know you, God. So we just pray in a fresh way this week, even in Thanksgiving, we might encounter who you are, God, in the Bible, in community, in prayer, God, would we encounter you, God? And Jesus, we also just long to be more of who you've called us to be, to not be stuck in our sin, but to be set free in who we are in you, Jesus. And so we invite you, Holy Spirit, to allow us to walk in the identity that you say of us, that we are your sons and daughters, loved by the Most High God, that you know us intimately, even as you know the whole universe, you know us, and how amazing that is, God. So we just pray that we would be able to take in that love today, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We want to know you. We want to be set free to be who we are in you, Jesus. So come. We can't do this for ourselves, God. Would you do it for us? We need your presence in our lives, Lord. So we pray these things in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. So I just bless you, church, to capture more of who God is in his fullness, and to walk in more of the truth of your identity in him as a son and daughter of the living God. Amen. Join us for Thanksgiving. Get some baked goods. Have a great Thanksgiving. Love you, church.
Before we go, let's bless the food and celebrate our Thanksgiving meal with the Thanksgiving to the Lord.
Yes.
Father God, we just thank you, Father. We thank you for your greatness and your goodness, that you are both almighty and you are both filled with love. God, that's the difference, that you are both, Lord. And we just want to thank you for our family and our friends, for our livelihood, for our homes, Lord, and for all the ways that you have blessed us. And I pray that you bless our conversation as we love one another through the fellowship of a potluck dinner, a lunch. We pray for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.